friends and family, welcome to the Random Show. I'm Kevin Rose.
I'm Tim Ferriss.
Cheers.
Cheers.
Welcome to the Vampire Edition. Nice and dark.
Episode 666.
Cheers.
There's the light incisors.
The Satan episode.
Now, why the lack of lights?
So, I just moved to New York. Mm-hmm. Thank you for visiting me.
Of course.
You're here in town. You're actually leaving tomorrow morning, but appreciate you making time.
Yeah, of course.
So we are shooting on my iPhone, shot on iPhone 6, if you will. Don't know how the audio is going to turn out, although we have a backup audio device here.
Yeah.
So hopefully good.
And if not, sorry.
Yeah.
Just have to make do. It's either this or no episodes.
It's the random show.
It's random.
It's supposed to be random.
That includes equipment. That's and right. Quality.
Next time we're going to shoot on an old VHS, like camcorder. And
8-track required.
Betamax.
Exactly. So why the move to New York?
Good question. I merged my company, which was North Technologies that I had in San Francisco, with Hodinkee. And Hodinkee is a mechanical watch blog that has been around for 7 or so years. We had a watch app on the mechanical collecting news aggregation side. I've had two glasses of champagne already. And so we had this app, Watchville, that was really taking off, but we didn't really have any editorial. Hodinkee's been around for a long time, respected blog that I've always enjoyed and read, and it just made sense to combine forces so we get a little bit of their editorial. They have our tech team, and now we're one big happy family building awesome products.
And I remember at one point we were eating at Blue Plate in San Francisco, a place that I like, and we were first talking about what later became Watchville.
Yeah.
And you were describing this luxury market to me, and I love high margin, or at least high-priced markets where people are somewhat price insensitive. It gives you a lot of flexibility to play. And what's really fascinating about it to me is how intensely passionate people are who become involved with these subcultures,
right? Yeah.
These subsets of the world. And I was talking to a buddy of mine who's been on my podcast. I won't mention his name yet because he might not want me to. But he has a particular watch that was worn on, I guess, the first moon landing.
Mm-hmm.
And
Speedmaster.
There you go. And he met up with a scientist who also had the same watch. And it became this topic of conversation. And I go, oh, well, at some point, I should probably introduce you to my friend. He's the CEO of Hodinkee. And he's like, what?
Yeah, totally.
And this is the guy who's never impressed by anybody. And I was like, really?
Yeah, amazing. I mean, the people that are in the know freak out, which is kind of nice.
Yeah, yeah.
It's still a shock to me, too. But, you know, we just actually...
Where did the name come from?
It's actually, what was it? Finnish for small watch?
Swedish
for small watch? Something.
Small watch, yeah.
Yeah, it's just spelled a little differently. So the domain was free. He registered it.
Yeah.
But the crazy thing is I did the stats today. I was looking in the numbers. And on Watchville, we had 1.3 million user sessions last month from users that had opened the app more than 200 times. So, I mean, you're talking about a small audience, but super engaged, just like constantly checking it. And it's been fun. I mean, I think there's a lot of pitfalls for people that are getting into collecting mechanical watches for the first time,
sure.
Including scams, like buying the wrong watch at auction. And so there's a lot of things we want to get in there and
not
fix.
Not having a service history.
Yeah, no service history, getting replacement parts like swapped out and they not even know it because the watch hasn't even been opened.
Right.
So anyway, it's a fun hobby turned business, and we're having fun doing it.
So speaking of collecting... What are we drinking here? What is this stuff?
So we are collecting, we are collecting in our mouth holes.
More wine.
Some Lambrusco, which is a sparkling red wine that my wife bought me. Do you know anything about this, babe?
Nope.
Sparkling red wine.
It's delicious. It has a lot of syllables, which means it must be very, very high quality. Lambrusco Mantovano, Viedanese Sabionetano. That's what it is. It's very tasty.
How well do you do?
I have no idea what he said.
She speaks Italian.
Culo, dimenticato tutto. Okay, anyway, that's all I got. So, major updates. What else you got?
I have a lot of stuff to talk about.
I wanted to have a serious biochemical conversation here. So, I received a text not long ago from your wife. And you've been a bit of a keto high priest, proselytizing the masses.
It's true.
And
I've converted like 80% of my office over to keto.
And you borrowed a novel that I had in my house.
Toto-chan.
And then I got this text from Daria saying, Kevin's gone completely flip-flop to the other side, bought a rice cooker, he's gone full Japanese, wants to go to the market. Tell me about this.
I mean, I love that this is funny to my wife. So, you know, the thing
nobody is... Nobody gets more excited more quickly than you.
That's right.
And also with equal passion drops things.
That's right. So,
which I should note, if Kevin's like, I just bought this amazing fill-in-the-blank thing, especially if it's any type of investment, you have to insist that he tells you when he sells it.
Well, first of all, I bought oil. Have you seen what that oil's been doing?
I have not, because that stuff, I don't have, you have bigger balls than I do for that kind of thing.
Anyway, so here's the deal. Like any proper geek, I like to go in and go heavy and go hard and go deep on any topic.
Geek.
Right. So I find myself like you get really excited about something like keto. And you told me about your little your glucose monitor, your ketone monitor, and you're pricking your finger 5 times a day. I started doing the exact same thing. We were trading texts about our different levels. I'm trying out different experiments with like how different things impact my blood sugar. I get into it.
It was cool. Yeah.
It was fun. And I lost a bunch of weight and I felt really awesome and it was great. But, you know, it had been a few months. I had done that and it's kind of run its course. And not to say I couldn't still keep doing it, but I started reading this book. And one of the things that you realize about ketosis really quickly is that, you know, it's a pretty hardcore lifestyle.
Boring as
like,
fuck.
Like, it's boring and it's a lot of fat, dude. It's like fat city all day, all night, fat, fat, fat.
Yeah, you feel like a human cheesecloth.
It's just, it comes out of your pores eventually. Yeah. And like, it was just like, it was so much fat. I wanted to change it up a little bit. And you lent me this
book. You went to rice.
No, you lent me this book. And it's actually a children's book. And one of the things that it said that I thought was really interesting is that there's these little kids that went to school had this, this teacher that taught them that in order to get a proper diet, one thing they had to do was eat something from the sea and something from the land every single day. And so the teachers would come along around and look in their lunch boxes, and if they didn't have something from the sea, they would bring a person behind them from the cafeteria that would scoop like sea vegetables onto their plate. So they made it mandatory there's something from the sea and something from the land to get a balanced diet. And so I was like, gosh, that's really interesting. Like, I don't do that. I don't have something from the sea every single day. And so I thought it would be interesting to think like, what if I just like went crazy and just did some work? I always have enjoyed all things Japanese. You know that.
Of course.
And so I started like, I pulled out my old book, The Okinawan Program, which talks about, I actually really don't like this book. I think it's a horrible book. Just because they try and fill in the blanks where they shouldn't be.
Right. They're like, speculate too much.
They speculate a lot. Like they're like, they talk about like one thing they were saying is that, we couldn't find the American equivalent of X, Y, and Z. So you should just have cucumbers. And I'm like, that has nothing to do with like bitter melon. Like right. Those are two completely different things. Yeah, like right. Why are you trying to draw? Or they'd be like, we recommend, what did they say? Oh, the Okinawans eat too much salt. So we recommend if you go to the store, buy low sodium. And it's like, no, they're the ones living to be 100, right. Not based on what your little changes to their diet.
And it's called the Okinawa.
Yeah, program. Exactly.
The Okinawa.
Program. Well, and they were also recommending like low-fat milk and all this stuff. And so I didn't like that. But what I did like about this book is they talk about a bunch of the random herbs that they eat that you would never have heard of. And actually, I ordered one on Amazon last night. Apparently, you could smoke it too, and like gives you this like super chill. Like mellow effect, like you can. It's called
maybe that's why they live so long.
No, it's called mugwort. It's crazy.
It's
you can do crazy stuff with it though. But you can also take it at bedtime, and it makes you have lucid dream, and also get really good night's sleep. And it protects against stomach damage. Anyway, there's all kinds of herbs in here to check out. So anyway,
do your homework. You might save your stomach and destroy your liver. It's true. Like a lot of people who drink tons of kava kava, or even like people drink catnip.
Yeah. Kava kava is hardcore. There's a kava kava bar down the street, like a bar that you can go to and they just like serve you ceremonial grade kava kava.
So a couple notes on Okinawa, just for people who might be interested. We spent some time in Okinawa and a few observations. Number one, and these are all subject to intense debate by a lot of folks. But they eat a fair amount of fat, number one, often quite a bit of pork.
Pork, yep.
They do eat a ton of sea vegetables.
Mm-hmm.
Very much a mainstay. They do not, in traditional Okinawan cuisine, as far as I can tell, eat much rice. They do eat the lower glycemic sweet potato, however, that's often purple. And so even if you go to the McDonald's in Okinawa, you can get that purple colored, like, taro ice cream. But the most striking thing about the places we went to Ogimi, which is the village where they have, I think it's the highest number of centenarians.
Centurions.
No, those are different. But per 100, per 1,000 people, whatever it might be. And they were all so engaged. None of them were tired. I just thought that was so fascinating. They were all they were active and they felt like they had a purpose. Like our driver, I mean, he must have been 80, 85. Dude, he was hopping out, running around. He was opposite of what you imagine for 85.
It's crazy.
Oh, yeah.
There's something out there.
Oh, you just hop out of the car. Like, I want to show you around. Let me take you for a walk. And we saw all sorts of interesting things there. But they don't always match up with the reports. So when in doubt, gather firsthand. So you moved to New York. Big movements on the company side.
Well, let me finish the Okinawan thing.
You're going full carb.
I'm going full carb. And as part of that, I got a rice cooker. And I also got some of this. Have you heard of this?
Gaba rice.
Do you know much about this?
I know zero about that.
So this is a special rice. It's a sprouted rice that has 750% more fiber than traditional rice. And GABA, which they say
lowers anxiety, increases sleep cycle, giving deeper rest, lowers blood pressure, and improves other cardiovascular functions.
It's got all these claims.
Butyric acid, yeah.
It's got all these crazy claims. It's really dense. It takes 3.5 hours to cook, which is the reason I got the rice cooker.
Is that what it's called, quick cooking?
Does it say quick cooking? It's amazing. It takes 3.5 hours.
Very slow, fast cook. I like it.
But it's really dense, so it's low glycemic. What I do, this is my breakfast, which I tell you, it gives me a ton of energy, okay? All Hear right. me out.
I'm ready.
I take a scoop of about 1.5 cups of GABA rice, which reduces my anxiety. And then I put a little bit of this on here. And I got this from the Japanese grocery store.
Nori tamago.
Nori tamago.
Furikake. Furikake just means you can sprinkle it on.
Yeah, so I sprinkle this on...
prepared sesame seed and seaweed.
Yeah. So you get... I put it on top of the rice and the seaweed kind of breaks down and loosens up a little bit. And then I put a couple eggs on top and break the yolks over the top of the rice with the seaweed and the sesame. It is amazing. Yeah, super like umami flavor. Super seaweedy. It's phenomenal.
Super seaweedy.
I mean, it's just like, this is my sea.
Are you a sommelier?
Something from the sea, something from the land. I have both in one little package there. All right, that's all I got to say about Okinawa.
All about the multi-package.
So I'm all about carbs right now.
So I suppose the biggest change in my life has been this big shift that I've considered for 15, 20 years. Finally happened, and that was adopting a dog. So
that is awesome.
Adopted little Molly, and little Molly is, I guess, about 5 months old now, and rescued her.
We're gonna put pictures
like
in
a month. We'll put some photos in.
You bought a from a breeder?
No. She was a rescue. She was from in a kill shelter in South Carolina.
You said not the same thing.
And she was. And she was brought by this French breeder. She was brought then to Long Island by a woman. Who saved an entire litter of puppies, all kind of mud blood, mutts of various types. And then I adopted her on Long Island. And
she's a sweetheart.
She is super
so sweet.
And got a lot of good advice when I went to adopt or prior to adopting. So I connected with a gentleman named David from Adopt-A-Pet, which is a really interesting service for adoption and facilitating that whole process. And among other things, you know, inspected the dogs, each dog I spent time with, each puppy, their paws, their ears, their muzzle, their tail, to see how they responded to that type of contact.
Hmm.
Or even being like held so that you could say, look for ticks and so on, very important on Long Island. And Molly's a sweetheart. She has a great temperament. And I did send away for this genetic test, which was Wisdom Panel. Very, very promising sounding name. It's kind of like 23andMe for dogs. And I got the report back and it's like 20 pages. And I'd say 19 and a half of those pages are, here's what genetics are. And the remainder is, congratulations, she's a lab mix. The rest might be. I'm like, wait, what? Really? I had to wait 4 weeks for that?
How much was that
test? You gotta be kidding me. I don't remember. It was like $50-$75, like something like that.
Still pretty bad.
And I was like, all right, well, that's pretty much as good as me having a bunch of wine and just guessing with my friends. Right. But she looks like Lab and I think Beagle. And I have a great trainer that we're working with named Gail, who very much agrees. Looks like a hound with a lot of sniffing. And you can do nose work competition, something I've been considering, but that leads to something a little more generalized, which is a fantastic book with a terrible title. And this is common. You can also find really terrible books with great titles, also very common. But this one is called Don't Shoot the Dog. And Don't Shoot the Dog is by Karen Pryor, who is considered by a lot of people to be sort of the mother of clicker training with dogs. And prior to working with dogs, she worked with dolphins and training marine mammals. And what makes that interesting is if you're in a pool with dolphin, you can't like slap them on the flipper and be like, bad dolphin, you know, like give them a timeout. They're dolphins. They'll just swim away. So you have to focus on positive reinforcement. And the way that you do that is you feed them obviously different types of fish and whatnot, but you use a clicker or a whistle in this case underwater to signal when they do a behavior or get closer to a behavior that you're trying to get them to complete. And this book, Don't Shoot the Dog, it's like it applies whether you want to get better at resolving conflict with your girlfriend, boyfriend, spouse, get your grandma to stop nagging, get the cat off the table, train your dog,
whatever. Do you
whatever.
Click your girlfriend?
No. That's I thought about this, but no.
Good girl.
No. Here's a kibble. No, but it does teach you about sort of
I wouldn't put it past you, by the way.
I wouldn't put it past me either, but I'll try anything once. But the insight into behavioral change is really awesome. I've just been so impressed, and I don't say that about a lot of books, but Don't Shoot the Dog, which was recommended to me by you guys, many of you listening, did a poll on Facebook. Fantastic book. Get the updated edition with a chapter on clicker training. But that's been, I'd say, the best read that I've had in a while.
What's been the most frustrating thing for you of having a new dog? You like to travel a ton, which was crazy for me. I knew that was going to be...
Yeah. Well, here's the thing. I travel a lot because I don't have a reason not to travel a lot. Right? And the fact of the matter is I love San Francisco. I love staying put and being a homebody. Now I have yet one more very powerful reason to stay put. So I think that I'll curtail the travel quite a lot. But the most frustrating thing I would say is realizing that with training a sentient mammal of probably any type, that the training isn't linear. Right? So you'll be making incredible progress. Like, oh my God, she learned to sit and lay and do this and fetch and da 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 all in one day. And you expect that progress to proceed kind of in a stair-step fashion. And no, it's like 3 steps forward, 7 steps back or whatever. A dog gets pissed off for some reason or it's just lethargic for God knows whatever reason. Maybe they did a lot of smelling.
Because you train it all day long.
Well, no, I don't
train. I was with you and you trained your puppy for 9 hours
that
day.
That's not true.
He trained it a lot.
Not 9 hours.
4 hours.
So I think there are a couple of, well, there are mistakes I made and things that were frustrating. I think they're tied together. So oftentimes it's like 3 steps forward, 2 to 5 steps back. Number one is if you're training a puppy, I can train for hours and hours and hours and hours, but it's really more effective to do short kind of 5 to 10 minute training sessions.
For how long
and break them
total
up
in a day?
You can do 3 or 4 of those in a day.
4 hours?
No, not 4 hours. Mm-hmm. You can do 3 or 4 of those in a day. And there's some really good programs out there. I think Recallers is one. Susan Garrett, I think her name is. I like her approach quite a lot.
Are you going to write a book on dog training?
I'm not going to write a book on dog training. There are better people out there. But I might write a blog post simply summarizing a few of the things that I've concluded based on talking to a lot of the top agility trainers, sort of protective dog trainers out there.
A lot of people would love that for you to like take all that information, condense
it
down.
It's so simple. It's just like, all right, crate training. Number one, do crate training. Number two, if a dog is bored or not tired at the end of the day, they're going to get into all sorts of trouble. So,
no doubt about that. We learned that
so
the hard
way. You know, get a Kong and fill it with kibble, but with a little bit of water. So you freeze it in the last 3 hours instead of 3 minutes. Mm. And if that doesn't work, like Molly wasn't able to figure it out. Her jaw was too small to kind of get inside this device, which looks like a kind of a plastic beehive that you put kibble inside of, so they have to work for it. Since dogs, or I suppose looking at their ancestors, just from a genetic lineage standpoint, would have spent the majority of their time looking for food. So if you just have them lay on the floor for 6 hours, they're going to go fucking nuts and develop neurotic tendencies like shadow chasing or light chasing. Bad game to do with your dogs, by the way. Shining like a light on the floor and making them go completely schizophrenic. Yeah, that'll bite you in the ass. But what this led me to do is also look at how the bond between human and canine developed. And there are so many interesting theories.
Can I?
Sorry.
No. I was just going to say one of the theories out there, this was just in National Geographic magazine, and a book has been written about this, is that part of the reason Neanderthals were effectively eradicated is that humans were able to domesticate wolves and use the wolves to pursue prey that the Neanderthals couldn't get with spears.
Hmm.
And so that they would, the dogs would be, or the wolves would act as hunting dogs, just like you might have people hunting mountain lions now, for instance, and then isolate the animal, sort of get it trapped in some capacity so that the humans could catch up and then hit these larger prey like woolly mammoths from a distance.
Hmm.
And you can see contemporary examples of this domestication of canines. If you just Google, I think it's Egyptian wolf and baboons. The Egyptian wolves, I might be getting that slightly wrong, but they will follow these baboons and be within several feet of them because the baboons, as they forage, make it easier for the wolves to get mice, field mice.
Hmm.
And the baboons do not have a similar truce with, say, jackals or feral dogs. It's only with this particular type of, I think it's a wolf. And it's a very interesting dynamic, but you can see how that would have progressed at some point to this domestication, this symbiotic relationship.
So can I, speaking of domesticating, can I talk about what you do outside with the dog at night?
I have no idea where this is going, but sure.
The bushes.
Taking a piss together?
Yeah.
Sure, go for it.
Why do you pee with your dog?
Well, there are a few reasons. Number one, I love peeing outside, so why not? One of the great underutilized pleasures.
I walked outside and he's peeing and he's like, what? The dog does it out here too. It's to train the dog. And I'm like, what the fuck are you talking about?
No. This is legit. So there are a couple of reasons for it. Get nature's miracle if you're going to adopt or get a dog. And I do encourage you to adopt, by the way. And just even for purely longevity purposes, you can dodge a lot of genetically isolated issues by doing that. But yeah, I pee outside, and I will warn you in advance, when you first get a puppy, if you pee outside and you're a male, as a woman, I'm sure it's different and much more awkward. But as a male, if you're just sitting there kind of pissing and minding your own business, the dog will run and put its head directly in your line of peeing. And they love getting, like having piss hit them right in the head. I don't know why. And I put this up and I was like, is it normal for a dog to just like want to put their head right in front of your piss? And,
you tweeted this out?
Yeah, and a lot of people replied, and they're like, actually, yeah, that's why my dog's nickname is Peahead. And I'm like, all right.
How many people?
Now I know, and I think it's because we both pee in the leaves. I want her to get used to peeing on the leaves as opposed to, like, short grass. Because if you train a dog to pee on...
You were shitting out there, too.
I shit on my dog to show her who's alpha. It would be too hard to explain here. I don't do that. People relax. So... But and you use the clicker as well as a whole component of this. But the point being that dogs are very texture sensitive. So for instance, if you use pee pads as part of your housebreaking, it's a terrible idea because it's similar in consistency to say like area rugs in the home. So they will then end up
we actually had that
hissing
problem.
All over area rugs.
Remember, Toaster was peeing on the area rugs.
Yeah, it's very, very common. So that's about that. I've been spending a lot more time outside though. I also put together a very cool pull-up rig, and I looked at all sorts of different options, and the simplest was, and I'll include photographs, but you can see it on my Instagram, which is just instagram.com/TimFerriss2RSOSs, like 1 1/4 inch galvanized steel, which is basically kind of a frame like that with a T-joint at the bottom of each, and then legs that are about, I guess, 3 feet in either direction. And I weighed them down. This is a key point. You don't want to do any kipping movements on this type of rig, but you can attach rings. I have Nyoya rings, which are plastic. I'd usually recommend wood, but this all stays outside. And you can do controlled muscle-up practice, pull-ups, dips, everything.
It's pretty cool.
And the entire rig, the rings are about $35, and the rest of it's like $100 to $200. What I added to that is weight. I was going to get sandbags to help weight it down. And instead, I bought kayak dry bags. So kayaking dry bags are intended to keep the elements like your iPhone or your whatever, wallet, etc., dry inside a bag. You can use it to keep water inside the bag, though. And so I loaded up these bags, and you can get them on Amazon for like 15, 20 bucks with 50 pounds of water each, and then put them on the base of this rig. So it's a pretty sweet setup, and it works exceptionally, exceptionally well.
Awesome. Yeah. I saw that over your house.
Yeah.
When we played wiffle ball.
That's right.
That hurt us more than anything else.
Yeah, we're getting old. My God. Both of us were so destroyed by playing. Like, we did play, though, like hours.
We did play hours.
Of wiffle ball.
Yeah.
And if you look at how either of us exercise, there's no rotational component at all.
Exactly.
And so we just basically struck out straight for hours. Not recommended. It was fun, though. What is this?
So there's a company, Suturage, which everyone should check out. Not everyone should check out. If you're looking for a special gift, and this is a little gift that I received, it is, Suturage is a company.
How do you spell Suturage?
Suturage.
And never would have gotten that.
And
right.
So they are this little tiny boutique company, have a handful of employees. And what they are is they're like ninjas for alcohol and wine. So if you want something really special for like a gift or a special bottle that you can't find, say you go to a restaurant and you take a picture of something and you're like, no, you can't find it anywhere online. They will go and hunt it down for you.
Oh, that's cool.
And they charge a little bit of like a margin on top of that, but they're like, they're really experts in this space.
Yeah.
So I got this bottle. This is a Pebble Ford. This is interesting. It was brewed in 1914. Pre-prohibition whiskey. They found it in a lot with a handful of other bottles. And I mean, this thing is like, they had to replace the label because this is a reproduction of the label, but it's the same bottle. You can see here it says 1917 when it was bottled.
Well, I also like the, I guess this is what, a QR code on the side where you can you can get more data.
Right. That you can scan with your phone.
Get more info about it.
They did that on all their wine bottles too.
That's really cool.
So you can find out when the best time to open the wine is and all that stuff. So anyway, this stuff was actually Jim Beam's son went and brewed this.
You say Jim Beam?
Jim Beam.
Okay.
Bean. I didn't say Bean, did I? Anyway, I want you to have a little taste of it.
Sure.
This is like, this is pre-prohibition whiskey.
Alright.
Sweet juice.
Cheers.
So,
Thank you.
Yeah, no worries. Anyway, these guys are pretty awesome. Great little company. Just want to give them a shout out. The awesome thing about this label, it says Medicinal Spirits Company. So this was sold as a medicinal spirit. Dude, that's
fantastic.
The first time you've ever had pre-prohibition.
You love that adjective.
I mean, it's pretty,
true.
It's
awesome.
It's pretty cool, though, right?
Yeah, it's very cool.
Yeah, you were supposed to say some of that for me. It's okay.
I should point out, this is a very convincing fake-aged label, which kind of underscores the importance of having someone who can curate this kind of thing for you, so you don't get screwed.
Oh, absolutely.
It's like Billionaire's Vinegar. If you guys haven't checked out Billionaire's Vinegar, you should check it out. It's about buying fancy wines.
Yeah, these guys are super legit. They when you buy something like this, they send you like a PDF of like pictures of the place where they got it, like the whole history. They pass on 90% of the stuff they're offered. Like, they really want to make sure it's like it's real. But anyway, nice folks over there. So you guys can try that there. Give it a shot. Anyway, that's all. I just thought it was something interesting. Nice little gift.
That's awesome. I like it.
Yeah.
And so something maybe a little, we'll span the entire spectrum of price points here. So a couple of things that I've been having fun with. Apps to Overcast. I've been playing with quite a bit for listening to podcasts, which I've really, really enjoyed. It's very sleek in its user interface. And my favorite feature is smart speed. So smart speed, instead of having like 1.25 or 1.5 or 2 or whatever, X the normal speed, smart speed reduces or eliminates pauses in between sentences and words in a way that doesn't affect your listening experience, but can save you dozens of hours of listening.
So if like someone pauses for 3 or 4 seconds, it just like cuts it.
Oh, even a half a second. It'll just cut that down to like a quarter of a second or a fifth of a second.
Daria loves that.
And
she's all about
it's
that.
Awesome. It's really cool. They have a lot, and they have, it has voice enhancement also. So if the audio quality is poor or mediocre, makes it easier to listen to. It's fucking great. So Overcast is really cool. And their in-app purchases, just to like pay the extra $4 and get the features, it just like save yourself a lot of headache. And then the other one is Tetris. So I had I interviewed Jane McGonigal on my podcast recently, and we were talking about her recovery from traumatic brain injury and her PhD, which looked at a lot of game development and psychology and whatnot. And Tetris can be used to prevent or minimize, for instance, PTSD. They've had studies done on this. And a very small amount of gaming can be used kind of prophylactically, I think probably curatively in a way, with, say, anxiety or other things. So using Tetris, and my girlfriend's been doing this too, for, say, 10 minutes before you go to bed is incredibly therapeutic. And I forgot how much I love Tetris.
I love Tetris.
And wasn't Wozniak at one point the Tetris world champion?
I don't know what the Woz was.
I think he was. Somebody can probably fact check that. But in any case, forgot how much I love Tetris, and it's actually quite cool how they adapted Tetris for a phone where you're just using your thumb.
Does it have multiplayer? Like where I could like battle you over Game Center?
Maybe.
That'd be pretty badass.
Love to look into that. Yeah. It's really fun though. I've really been enjoying it. What do you have over there?
So two more things, just like fun little treats for the house. This one, have you heard of this company?
I have. Yeah.
What do you think?
Yeah, they have bars too, don't they?
Yeah, they do.
Like bison bars.
Their bars are a little too sugary for me.
I think they have a lot of cranberries.
Yeah, cranberries and stuff in them. So this is it's a company called Epic. I found this recently. This is just straight up uncured bacon, which is just pork, water, sea salt, celery powder, and that's it. And it's great. It's like a great beef jerky replacement.
I like that they just have a picture of a big cow. Like, no, it's not
pig.
Just one big fat pig on the front. So you know exactly what you're eating. Yeah.
See, I'm curious to get your taste. Yeah.
I mean, I love jerky. It's hard to go
wrong. But do you like bacon jerky?
I think it's very likely. Is this a dog treat?
Yes.
It does kind of look like a dog treat.
Just here.
Dog treat on cue is right here. Yeah, it's good.
Okay.
It's very good. It's not. It's not too tough.
Right. Yeah.
All right, Toasty.
So one other thing I want to mention that I'm done for the day.
This is amazing. This is some of what you get.
What did you think? Did you like it?
It's great. It's so good.
All right. There's a place here in New York. You can call them up and see if they'll ship it. But it's Greek Yogurt Lab in Manhattan. And what they do is they make yogurt fresh in really small batches. Like you can walk into this place. They have these little tiny tubs where they make yogurt there. But as part of the byproduct, they go and they create butter. Fermented butter, grass-fed fermented butter. So when I was big into the keto world, they actually will also make you kind of a bulletproof-esque coffee in the morning. Right down the street, if you get up in the morning, you can like have them like whisk this into some coffee for you. But yeah, really good fermented butter. I use it with eggs in the morning or whatever else. But you know, we've talked about fermented foods in this show before and making certain nutrients more bioavailable. I love fermented foods. I try and eat at least something fermented every single day. And this is something I thought was cool. Grass-fed, too.
So I've been pre-prohibition fermented butter, I think. And I had a question for you, Daria, actually. Because I ended up just eating this basically by the spoonful. Because I'm a disgusting human being. But also because I was thinking about it. I was like, if there are a lot of probiotics in this from being fermented, I don't really want to put it into like 200 degree
right.
coffee, because it would just ixnay on the probiotics, I would think. Yeah, so there you have it. Daria's nodding. So.
Yes. Also, yeah, but Wozniak was the Tetris champion.
Oh, he was. Yes. We have a confirmation. Woz, well done, sir. Multifaceted, multi-talented.
Yeah,
you
but
are.
So is your stomach.
Multi-talented?
Yes. It's gonna kill all the bacteria, right? In theory.
No.
Why?
Work.
No, but there's heat in your stomach.
There's acid in your stomach.
There's acid in there as well.
They survive that.
Do they? Yes. So at what temperature do they die?
You can comfortably stick your finger in water. You can put something with live probiotics in it and won't die.
So it's if you comfortably
like
put it in water.
Or something fermented.
If you can comfortably put your finger in the liquid, you can put
they
probiotics.
They thrive at body temperature.
They thrive at body temperature. Okay. Yeah.
The bacteria.
Yeah, I mean, so then why do we have, why do you buy probiotics in the refrigerated section of the grocery store?
Probably make them last longer.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Make them last longer.
They're like sea monkeys.
Ah, okay. Well, just, that's what you had to say. I mean, why don't you just say that at the beginning?
I should repackage sea monkeys as some kind of probiotic.
Yeah.
I bet I could sell tons of it. So I only have two things left myself. This is a pretty simple one, quite frankly. And this is not going to be new to a lot of people, but it was for me. So I have seen noise-canceling headphones everywhere on every flight.
Mm-hmm.
And never really saw the value in getting a set because they're big. They're a little bulky. You can fold them up and so on. But I got a really nasty ear infection, and I couldn't use earbuds. So I bought, these are Bose, and I bought a pair of these, and I love these things. And what I really love about these is I also have a mic on it. Welcome to 99, but here's the thing. There are a lot of people out there who are not cutting edge early adopters like Kevin Rose.
Everybody has
those.
You're
such a racist.
Like 10 years ago.
Kevin's so racist. Out of high school.
Thank you. I'm just kidding. I'm kidding. Keep going.
So
clicker train me.
I will clicker train you. Most disobedient friend I have. So anyway, I will just say these things are expensive, but for me, they've really, really been a good investment. And I didn't realize how much discomfort earbuds were causing until I started using these.
Did you get
even without the ear infection?
Are those the rechargeable ones?
These are not rechargeable, but
Jordan has those. I actually really like those as well.
Oh yeah,
they're a little smaller, but they don't go over ear. They're on ear.
Yeah, I really like the over ear.
Do you sleep with those on a plane?
I do. And what I found actually is if for instance, if I'm sleeping and my head can kind of flop from side to side, it's very hard to sleep. And I don't like carrying those neck pillows because I always lose them. Unless I have a jacket that I can convert into a neck pillow, which is quite cool. You can check that out. Google it. But this actually prevents you on some level from rotating your head.
Mm.
So I found this very helpful for sleeping.
Those look nice. They actually have a blue lining. I haven't seen those yet. Those are new.
Oh, yeah. These are great. And just
I've always liked the Bose. I've had like three pairs.
And even without turning this on, they have a great insulating effect. And then the last, that was Doogie Howser a little moment. Excuse me, folks.
You're losing your voice, by the way. Are you getting sick?
No. I was at a friend's birthday party and was screaming at a club for hours.
You at a club?
Yeah, I know.
Oh, that's right. You were out of country.
I was out of country. That's so weirdly not
pseudo-British
of you. I was on holiday, that's right. And I listened to an audiobook while walking around in Sweden. And there's a wonderful walk if you go to this island right basically inside Stockholm where the king used to hunt. It used to be a private island. Now it's public. But I listened to a book that I had read many, many, many times before. It's super short, called Anything You Want by Derek Sivers. So Derek... if you know that name. Derek is one of these philosopher kings of programming, I would say. And he started a company called CD Baby, which he sold for
$20-something million.
But one of the deepest, sort of philosophically interesting guys that I've ever met. And we've spent a good amount of time together. But Anything You Want takes several decades of his experience and wraps it into a very short audiobook that takes about an hour to listen to. It's great. So I've read that several dozen times. I think the lessons are that powerful and that tangible. And listen to the audiobook, and he is a great voice performer. So if you haven't heard it, it has the weirdest artwork for an audiobook I've ever seen. It's a little kid buried up to his neck in sand with like that face. I don't know where that came from exactly. But Anything You Want by Derek Sivers, who's also at Sivers on Twitter. So a good guy to follow. Anybody come to mind as a suggested follow?
On Twitter?
Yeah, or the socials.
Mm.
People might not think of immediately offhand.
You know, I liked your podcast interview with Dr. Rhonda Patrick.
Yeah, Rhonda Patrick's great. I think she's, Found My Fitness?
Yeah, Found My Fitness, I think.
Yeah, Rhonda Patrick, RH. Rhonda Patrick, very, very good. She's got some really good stuff.
One thing I'll say, last parting words of wisdom from me, is that we just moved to new places, you know, as we talked about. Wine glasses, Zalto, Zalto. How awesome are these glasses?
These are great.
I owe you a pair. I've always threatened to buy you some.
Oh, that's right. I am a little worried about breaking.
They're not going to break.
They're not going to
break. Wash them in the dishwasher, no problems.
Cool. They are beautiful.
They're amazing.
Zalto?
Zalto, Zalto. Best I've ever found.
Oh, You know what? I have a question for you.
Shoot.
Watches. Yes. So I needed a timepiece, as they say.
For what?
Not too long ago. I just wanted one. So I guess need is a strong word.
Okay.
I didn't want to look at my phone. And I didn't want to carry my phone, but I wanted to keep track of the time. What type of watch would you recommend for me that costs $100 or less? If you had to pick one.
Do you want mechanical or do you want quartz?
I don't care.
You just want something to keep the time.
Maybe I should, but I don't really.
Digital?
Whatever you would recommend for less than $100. You know what? I'll say less than 200. There's a Seiko.
There's a Seiko made in Japan. It's automatic. What is it? The Seiko?
Seiko 5.
That
That's easier.
Everyone.
You have an Amazon Prime.
Oh, yeah.
Amazon Prime. And if you want mechanical, it is by far the best deal.
Oh, it is mechanical.
Yeah, it's $75. It's
now, amazing. I'll ask a silly question. What is the advantage of mechanical over quartz?
There's no advantage, except the fact that you have a nice mechanical handmade watch that's amazing.
It's just more interesting craftsmanship.
Yeah, and it just like, it gives you a reason. Like, honestly, I've found this to be true. It gives you a reason to stop in the morning and just relax a little bit and wind your watch.
I like that, actually.
It's not just That's about cool. like rushing and grabbing and heading out. It's
Have you ever thought about smoking a pipe?
My dad used to smoke a pipe.
I fucking love the smell of pipes.
Love if tobacco didn't cause cancer, I would smoke. I'd be smoking.
I'm
right
not
now.
Suggesting smoking. I don't smoke, but I do love the smell of pipes. And I've had multiple relatives who smoke pipes.
Man. I do too. All
right.
You can't smoke a pipe, dude. Don't do it.
I don't think I will. I will do the tiki toss. That's a fun game.
What's the tiki
board
toss?
Hook and then
oh, I
a
love
ring
the
on a rope,
toss.
And it does help if you've had a bit of this. Not really help in accuracy, but it helps you to do it for longer.
I mean, people have no idea what you're talking about right now.
Okay, this is popular in the Caribbean. It is a game whereby you have a hook of some type that is mounted to a wall, and then you have a string attached to the ceiling. It comes down to a ring, and you stand about 6 feet away. You try to just
and
swing
it kind of glides in
this loop on top of the hook. And it sounds incredibly boring, like it could be a punishment, but it's really fun.
Yeah, you have to have, you kind of have to get around the ring to hook it on the backside.
It's kind of the idea. Correct. Very well spoken. But you can buy a kit. So this is what I bought. It was this this wooden kit that you can basically stick to the wall or mount with screws. That allows you to do the whole thing. And I put it off and put it off because I thought it was going to take a long time to put together, and it took less than 5 minutes to assemble.
Yeah, it's fun. We spent like 5 hours playing that game.
We did. Wine helps tremendously with fueling that type of competition. And crazy, you remember this? When we were sucking really hard for a while. And I'll just speaking for Kevin, not for myself. We were doing poorly. Let me rephrase that. And and we said, let's try it with our eyes closed.
Oh, this is...
So we miss. And there are people who miss like the first 50 to 100 times. Let's try with our eyes closed and just feel it and try to use the force. And so Kevin goes, boom, first attempt.
Nailed it.
And I'm like, oh, shit. And so I get up there, close my eyes, first attempt, nail it. And then I'm like, okay, all right, let's try that again. Does it again, nails it. I do it again, nail it. And then Kevin's like, I think we retire and walk away. We're done at this point.
It was an awesome game.
Yeah, it's a fun game.
It's a great way to kill some time.
You can do it. You could certainly figure out a way to mount it indoors also. So tiki toss, T-I-K-I. Or I could, and then piss off everybody who has some say in such things.
There you go.
What else you got?
Anything
else?
That's it.
All right.
I think we're done.
Think that's
it. Is it still recording or have we just been going on? Looks like it's going.
Sweet, it's still recording.
That would be amazing if you didn't hit record.
I recorded a podcast on my own. I did a podcast on my own recently and recorded the whole thing, like monologue, and finished. And I was like, oh, I nailed it. Awesome. And then I saw a flashing memory button and I only got 20%. It's just like, but we didn't do that this time. We got it. So, till next time.
Till next time.
See you guys.
See ya.